Fantasy Rugby Draft Podcast. My name's Bruce Hawkinson. Thanks for downloading and listening. In this podcast, we're going to analyse the South African Super Rugby squads for 2016. So, to that end, we thought we'd get someone on who actually knew what they're talking about. Brendan Nell from Supersport. Welcome, mate. How are you?
Pleasure, mate. Always good to be here. And yeah, I'm good. Good this morning.
Excellent, excellent. I like to think of you, Brendan, and maybe you get this reference, but the Adam Schefter of South African rugby. The breaking news. We've been following you for a bit now. Always a good source of stuff that comes out quite quickly. And also I've seen recently, not necessarily attributed to you. Some people lift and replace, which is a bit naughty, but certainly I see you as a good source.
Well, thanks, man. Yeah, it's always, you're always trying. That's what journalism is supposed to be about. You're supposed to be breaking stories. But yeah, lately, I must admit, the journalists seem to live from press conference to press conference. And yeah, let's hope that changes in the future.
Indeed, mate. Indeed. And also joining me in the booth is the man primarily made of moss, Nathan Mossman. How are you? Did your sun tanning go okay? Your sun bedding?
Yeah, I get the impression that every time I'm not here, I get accused of doing certain things that I haven't done. I've also discovered that I'm the unofficial chairman of the Charlie Nartai fan club. Even when I'm not physically present on this podcast, I seem to be there talking about him. So I might as well embrace it. I'm all wrong with that.
We just figured Waikato bias. If it's not Aaron Cruden, it's going to be Charlie Nartai, right?
Yeah, I like it. Yeah.
Yeah, very good. A little bit of admin. You can follow us on Twitter at Fantasy Rug Draft. That's Fantasy RUG Draft, or drop us a mail on support at fantasyrugbydraft.com. Brendan, you're on at Brendan Nell with B-R-E-N-D-E-N-N-E-L.
Yeah.
Good man.
Different way of spelling it. Everybody gets it wrong. So
well, for the New Zealand listeners, right, we're very much an A-N at the end. But it's very similar to Joe Peterson and a few of those chaps as well, isn't it?
Yeah, that's very true, yeah.
All right, so we've got quite a few to go through, a few teams to go, and one extra team this season to go through, so I thought we'd just plough straight into it and go with the last year's best performing team, the DHL Stormers, Brendan. So I guess for Fantasy Rugby Draft users, the first question they're going to want to know, and probably actually most of the Stormers fans are going to want to know, what's your best bet on who's going to be running the cutter? Who's the fly half?
Well, I'd say they go with the youngster, with Robert Dupree. He did pretty well in the Currie Cup season for them, and he's a good young up and coming fly off. Kurt Coleman is obviously the guy who was there last season, but with his kicking problems last season, unless he sorted those out, I can't see him doing too much in this season. Of course, we've got other transformation targets, so that might come into play depending on who else is selected, but I'd go for the youngster there. I don't think there's anybody else really that's going to come through as a bolter at this stage of the season. Of course, the teams haven't really done their preseason stuff yet, and you usually pick up those guys there.
Sure. We heard a couple of rumours, we won't mention any names, but you don't see any new big names joining the squad at this late stage?
Not really. I think maybe if Eddie Jones was still there, he might have been able to lure one or two guys.
Sure.
I think the big problem we've got is currency. It's just too expensive to bring guys in from overseas. And it's usually guys who finished up in Europe and want to come home look for an extra season. But, another guy you're probably talking about is Johan Huis, and there was some interest in him. He's struggling there at Racing Metro in France. He's not really getting too much game time, and he's a great talent. But the problem is, he's still earning a lot of money there at Racing, and I don't think the Stormers can really afford him at the moment. So, my last thing I heard on that was that there was talk, but that's where it stopped. It didn't really go further than that.
Okay. Yeah. Now that's good to know. I was wondering if they would kind of try their hand at Dupree. He's, what age is he at now? Cause he is young.
Yeah, he's 22, I believe now. Yeah, he was in the 20s 2 or 3 years ago. So yeah, he's still very young. Played alongside, in fact, when they played in the 20s, Andre Pollard, the current Bok Flav, he had a shift to inside center. So, he is seen as a very good goal kicker. I don't think he's as good in running a back line, but he's a very solid goal kicker and a very solid player.
He's going to have some pretty good players around him, aside from, let's say, the sevens and maybe injury. But once that team has their full abundance of starting players, he doesn't really need to do a hell of a lot at 10. He's a little bit like Jake McIntyre at the Reds. He's got some pretty good players outside him. He just needs to be, I guess, competent and kick goals.
Yeah, well, I suppose that's the ideal, is having that, you know, experience inside and out and giving the guy the sort of time to settle into the position. I think it is rather daunting. And, for any young player coming into Super Rugby, I don't think that we often realize that if you have to play against the likes of a Julian Surveyor one week and Israel Folau the next week and, you know, these big name players that you probably watched growing up, how much it affects you when you get onto that field. So, I think that's the nice thing is that he can settle in and he should have quite a lot of support and experience around him.
Yeah, it's a good point. So to that end, actually, so do we know much more about Damien Delander's injury? That was a bit of a body blow for the Stormers.
Yeah, and you know, there's a bit of a debate that's going to probably start here soon in South Africa because they let a lot of the Springboks go over to Japan to play for these 3 months that between World Cup and Super Rugby. And Damien and Andre Pollard both returned with injuries, and Andre is one they haven't said how long it is yet, but we're looking at probably a couple of months for both of them. So, yeah, you got to wonder where these guys should have been having a rest, whether it was really wise for them to go. Of course, money is what obviously sways the decision there as well. Yeah. And, so I can understand that. But, yeah, Damon is probably going to be out for, as far as I know, probably the first month at least of Super Rugby. And then I suppose it depends on his rehabilitation.
Mossman, so we have Damien somewhere in the middle of the second round, probably, number two? We did have number two midfielder. How far do you reckon that drops him down if he's out for that long?
Well, I think he would have been number one.
Do you reckon?
We would have been number one, I think, for me, based on... I mean, I'm assuming that Mike Harris was the number one you were thinking of. Yeah.
That's right.
So I think there's a little bit of doubts surrounding Mike Harris, especially based on some of the things that Reg said last time round. So, so I think they'll definitely swap places based on that. Whether you drop them down too much further, possibly not.
Fikitoa, Karibi, those types of players, would you still draft them? Because to be honest, I mean, Damien Delinde's output per game when he is fit, and if he is back for your playoffs or that last push to playoffs, he's not far. He's not going to drop far for mind.
No. Agree.
Yeah, and he makes a lot of meters. I mean, he's good definitely for you guys' fantasy stuff. So, yeah, he's a solid guy and he performs consistently. So.
Oh, as an All Black fan, he scares the shit out of me. He's awesome. He is.
He's a big boy. Yeah? He's a big boy. You're going to stand next to him, you'll see. He's
really?
Built well. So, yeah.
He just glides through tackles. No, we've got the poster up on the wall of the FRD Towers. He's an impressive piece. Moving on, I guess, we touched on it before, what impact, and it's really difficult at the moment to know because teams haven't been settled for Rio, but what impact do you think the Sevens are going to have on the Stormers? Because they potentially have two or three players that could be pulled out of that team.
Well, I think it'll have quite a big impact because, I mean, if you look at the way they play, the guys who are their game breakers, I mean, I know he's not the greatest on defense, but Chesson Colby is amazing on attack. The way he steps through tackles at times and just seems to beat defenders one-on-one. He's the type of guy you want on the field at some point. And Jean de Jong is obviously the captain, the most experienced guy. He's really the rock in that Stormers side, him and Scott Berger. I think they'd want them back. I spoke yesterday to Neil Powell over there in Wellington as they were preparing for the Sevens there, and he was saying that they've got them probably still for the Vegas Sevens and maybe for Vancouver.
Okay.
So if you put that they'll probably miss the first game or two of the Super Rugby season, but they should be there pretty much from there onwards. And I think, you know, there's enough experience there that those guys can just slot in pretty easily. They don't need much time to come back either.
Yeah, no, the stormed on the scene last season, didn't he, Chelsen? He played very, very well.
Yeah. And I haven't written it yet, but it's probably going up in the next couple of days. Also, because I just got to do a bit more research on it, but Stormers might actually even get a Francois Hoogaard as well, because that was also mentioned yesterday that he might go back to Super 15 for Super 18, sorry, Super Rugby.
Is that right?
For a couple of games. So they're not expecting him to use him past Vegas. And then get him back for the sort of June series again. So they pretty much, let him go for that. I'm just going to find out where he's negotiating.
Sure.
I know he was negotiating with the Bulls, but, I think that fell through the last I heard. So he's based in Cape Town with the Sevens team now at the Stormers, close to the Stormers ground. So it makes sense if he chats to them, and he's better than most of the halfbacks they've got. So you might be surprised and see him there for a couple of games this season as well.
That's very interesting, because I heard Saru were kind of dangling him out for the Kings at one point, trying to see if they can manufacture something there, but I always thought that was fairly dead in the water.
Yeah, the thing with him is he went through a bit of a bad patch, because he, it's one of these things where the agents get involved. The story I've heard is that he signed to go to Japan, and then he wanted to play Curry Cup for the Bulls. And then his agent told him, don't worry, you can leave off the Curry Cup. And then, of course, the Japanese club apparently got upset and cancelled his contract.
Sure.
He was suddenly left at the end of the season without a contract, without obviously this extra cash. And he was out of contract at the Bulls as well at the same time. So, the Sevens came up at the right time, but I think he's taken quite a drop in income. So it's okay. Probably one of those situations.
Yeah, it could be. So Nick Groom was at the starting halfback at the end of last year, wasn't he, for the Stormers?
Yeah.
So chances are they'd probably go over top of him if he did sign.
Well, they've also got Yano for Mark. And
yep. Has he come back? He's an ex-Bull, right?
Yeah, ex-Bull, ex-Lion. And he's back from France. He played for the Stormers in the Curry Cup, or the Western Province in the Curry Cup. And so he'll be there as well, and he's quite experienced. He's probably in his last year or two of his career at the moment, so they might not go with him all the time, but they've got him as experience as well to back up.
Looking a little bit closer into the scrum, loose forward trio with Vermaelen gone now, is that just as simple as saying it's Carr, Berger and Khaleesi, or is there other considerations in there?
No, I think that's pretty much where it would stop. It depends on the opposition. They got Reinhard Elstad, who's obviously the abrasive for this forward as well. He'll come in at some times as well. They've got Peter Steph Du Toit, the Springbok lock, who's moved down there, but he can also play seven. Mm-hmm. So they've got a couple of guys like that. But I think that would probably be the mainstay guys. Obviously, depending on how Berger holds up, he's just an incredible machine, the way he just keeps on going.
Yeah.
And anybody who watched him at the World Cup knows a guy his age to be making so many carries is unbelievable. So as long as he's fit and he's carrying on, I think that's pretty much the loose trio. They got another guy, I think his name is, I never get it, he's got one of these hard to pronounce first
I know name. Who you're going to say, because I struggle with it too.
Yeah, his surname's Notche. A very good young up-and-coming black news forward.
Yep.
And he's also going to probably get a look in somewhere in the season as well. And he probably in the next year or two is probably going to fill in when Berger retires.
He scored not a length of the field try in the end of Super Rugby last year, but a near to it. He just ran away from a couple of players. I can't remember who they're playing against, but that kind of stuck out to me as thinking, wow, who's this guy?
Yeah, he's got a lot of talent, a lot of speed. A couple of things in his game he needs to work on, but definitely a rising star that I know a number of the other provinces have been trying to poach, but haven't got around to. He's pretty happy in Cape Town, so I expect him to get a bit more game time this year.
Mossman, Carr, Berger or Khaleesi, which one of those would you rank highest?
Probably Carr.
I think so, right? When he came in, he looked pretty good. He picked up yards and offloads.
Yeah, well, he was good two seasons ago. Last year, I think it was a more slow start, kind of came on a little bit towards the end, but just purely from a fantasy. I think he's probably more, maybe fair to say that he's probably more nailed on for a start than Khaleesi is as well. Mm-hmm. I just get the feeling that he's was more of a fixture in the team than Khaleesi was.
Mm-hmm. You're just a fan of the beard?
Well, I guess part of that was because Vermaelen was there, and now that he's gone,
Cool. All right.
Well, I think that's the biggest loss for the Stormers is Vermaelen. I think Khaleesi's problem has been his form has been up and down a lot of the time. I know he's had a couple of personal problems in the last year. Hopefully, those have been sorted out now. But when he's on song, he's a great player. But he definitely is the guy. If out of those three, if they're going to play a Reinhard Elstad, if for the first game against the Bulls, where they want another Brazier forward in their pack, either counter the Bulls, then I think he's probably the guy who's going to be dropped. Then Kahnberger and Elstad will probably be the guys to start there. But I think the nice thing about Kahn is he's great the way he interacts with the back line. He's a little, the way he links up with them between the forwards and backs is pretty good as well. So,
Nice one. I think so. You'd say Colby was nailed on one at fullback. Dylan Leitz did enough to nail down in the other wing, would you say?
I don't know. He had a bit of a strange one in the Curry Cup.
Oh, really?
The Bulls beat Province for the first time in a number of years, and it came through an intercept that he threw, and just before it, he scored a try and was dancing, quite a lengthy dance in behind the goal line, and the stories for the next couple of days were all about how his coach was all upset that he kept on dancing. He was all more worried about his dance than he was about anything else. And so he got dropped for a game or two after that, and he's come back. He's certainly a player who's very much a form player. If he's in form, he's brilliant. But he has got the ability when his head dips to, just go off the boil a bit. I think the big addition there will be for the other wing. It will be Cornel Hendricks, yep. The Cheetahs, the winger, and Springbok winger. He's definitely, I can see him starting. And then another guy, big strong guy, Cobus van Wyk, who's back from injury as well. He's also a pretty impressive player as well, and can play in the midfield as well. I'd see him starting, depending on who you're playing. I think if you have Leeds and Colby, you've got two of your back three that are under 90 kgs. And when you play some of the teams, the bigger backs with the bigger Pacific Islands sort of back threes, then you can maybe struggle there as well.
So was it Cobus van Wyk in Australia? He had those two really strong games against the Waratahs last year. Looked very, very impressive. Big fella.
Yeah, big strong boy, and he definitely has had a bit of injury problems, but hopefully he can have a good run, this year, and I can see him actually nailing down the one wing spot if he does have a good run.
So with Dylan Leeds, was it the quality of his dancing that upset the coach? did he sort of need to go away and work on a few moves?
I think it was more the maybe the arrogance, because you're sitting at a full Loftus Versfeld with the opposition fans. It was almost like taunting them, and it's sort of the Bulls players said afterwards how it almost spurred them on to come back. So I think that was why the coach was a bit upset.
The old red rag to a bull, so to speak.
Yeah,
the fans at Loftus are famously very tolerant of things like that, so sure it went down well.
Yeah. And actually, that's a good one to pull out, though, with Cornel Hendricks. We haven't really discussed him in the rankings summit, did we, Mossman? And I'm just trying to search for him now in the rankings, and I can't find him.
No. He was another player that was very hit and miss, though, very consistent. Can quite easily come out, have a game where he busts off a couple of long runs or scores a couple of tries, but he'll go missing a lot of weeks as well.
So you could pretty much say that for anyone in the Cheetahs, right?
Yep. I think that's probably a fair comment.
Yeah. So I think put him in a good back line. Sorry, go ahead, Brendan.
Yeah, I was just going to say that. I mean, when he's got quality around him, I think the problem with the Cheetahs was there's a number of guys in their back line that are hit and miss, and they don't always perform. And their defense, and his defense has been probably his weakness in the last couple of years. But since he's been at the box, he was unlucky not to go to the World Cup, and he has improved. So I think in a good back line, you can see he's got a great sidestep, and he's definitely a try scorer. So he'll score a lot of tries if he gets a lot of game time. So defense wise, is probably his downfall though.
Yeah, I think that's one to stash in your back pocket for any Serie B draft managers, because I'm not sure. Yeah, it's high on a lot of people's radars. All right. Yeah.
So I was just thinking, with sevens players, because generally they actually, you'll find that they'll slim down a lot, so their fighting weight for 15s is a lot higher, and they'll need to sort of put some muscle back on a lot of them when they come back into 15s after playing sevens. I assume that this isn't going to be a problem for Colby, though. I think if he slimmed down, he'd be riding the winner in the derby or something, wouldn't he? So,
exactly.
Yeah,
I think he's pretty much the same the whole time. So, yeah. another point on Cornel Hendricks is the other thing that always plays a factor is he's also back home, because he comes from the Cape. So, he's back in his hometown now. So that could play a difference as well. It's always, I always find when, you know, the guys are back home and near their families and stuff, they seem to play better as well.
Absolutely agree. Absolutely. All right, let's move on to the Lions. We loved how they played last year. It was a kind of, they split the season in half. They played away from home. They were very resolute, the brick wall. I think their tackling percentage was something that was off the charts when they were playing away from home. But when Ackerman got them home, you just asked them to express themselves a hell of a lot more. And there's some really star performances in there. But a couple of those guys picked up a couple of pre-season injuries or injuries somewhere along the line, Harold Forster and Ruan Cumbrink. Do we know what the story was with those guys at the moment?
Well, yeah, both of them, we actually got a press conference in the next day or so to talk about that. But most of them should be back, as far as we know, by the, either the first or second week of the of Super Rugby. There's no real huge injuries with them. No one that's out for the season. That's what we were told last week. So, I think they both, most, they should have a squad, their full squad ready by second week of Super Rugby. But yeah, they decided that if you go look at what they did last year and the year before, they changed 5-6 players every game. So they certainly use their squad system and they don't mind rotating. And yeah, I think that probably, if they lose one or two guys, it's not going to hit them that hard in that respect.
So, I think if, you tell me, Brendan, but if this wasn't a, if wasn't a World Cup year last year, I suspect Ruan Cumbrink would have gone close to the box, right?
Yeah, I think there's a number of players. Jakob Kriel, their loose forward as well. Him, Warren Whiteley, Elton Yankees, Lionel Mapuhi. There's a number of those guys who are very, very close. And the problem, I know there was a lot of unhappiness from their fans that they didn't really get anybody into the World Cup squad, but it's one of those when you've got a Dwayne Vermeulen and a Skulpberger and you can only pick 5 loose forwards, and we've got pretty good loose forwards in this country. Those guys are always going to lose out. And when you have to pick between a Mornay Steyn and an Elton Yankees for the third fly-off position, and the one's got 70 tests on him, those are the type of decisions the Bok coach had to make. I feel if it wasn't the World Cup year, there'd be a lot more Springboks in their team. Their biggest plus is that, when they went out of Super Rugby for a year, they basically kept that same squad together, for 4 years. So, They haven't lost anybody to the box. They haven't really had big injuries, and they've had the same, more or less 90% of the same squad together for 4 or 5 years. So, that's their biggest, plus point, is that they've got that continuity. But then again, this season, a lot of teams will have worked them out, will have analyzed their play. They're not the unknown factor that they were in the past as well. So it's going to be interesting to see how they go.
Whenever I watched a Lions game, certainly when they're at home, all I can remember is seeing Faf running down the middle, or Mapo or Cumbrink. Those three, at any one point in time, were always just sprinting away from people. Just very, very impressive watching those guys.
Yeah, and they've got a loose trio as well that sort of links up. They almost can fit in the back line, all their loose forwards. And they link up with the back line pretty well as well. And Warren White is probably going to be the most underrated player in South Africa. He's really can't imagine him not being in the Springbok team this year if he carries on playing like he does. That's sort of thing. They've taken what John Mitchell taught them a couple of years ago, and they've taken it forward, and they've got a lot of confidence. They had a storming Curry Cup. They won it pretty easily. I don't think they lost a game in the whole Curry Cup season. So they've got that momentum as well to take them through.
Mossman, so that loose forward trio, Jakob Kriel was a star last year for fantasy. He wasn't drafted by a lot of folks either. He'll be on a lot of people's radar this season. But where do you rank him, out of curiosity?
Yeah, well, I was quite keen to ask Brendan just whether, I mean, purely from a fantasy rugby point of view, the reason he was the top scoring loose forward in the game was basically he led the meters gained category and also the defenders beaten category. And I just wonder if, having watched him a bit more closely, if you think that kind of performance is repeatable, if you think he can step it up even from what he did last year. Just be interested to know what you think.
Well, I think he can. I think he's definitely a good player. I think his biggest drawback, and I suppose is this always comes, debate comes up at this time of year, is probably his size when it comes, when games get tight. He likes a free-flowing game, and that's why the Lions game suits him as well. So if the games are like that, you can see him. He pops up on the wing a lot. He makes a lot of meters, and I can see it again. He was the Curry Cup. We haven't had the awards yet here for last year, but he's 99% certain he's going to be the Curry Cup Player of the Year as well. I had a similar barnstorming season with him, and I can see him doing it again. But I think it very much determines how his team plays as well, because when they get that go forward and momentum, they're extremely dangerous, and they, especially on turnovers, they love running the ball off turnovers and spreading it wide. So yeah, if they get ball and they get possession, he'll definitely be up there.
And there's also a question mark around him being in the sevens as well, is that correct?
Yeah, he was one of the guys named for the sevens, but I must admit, with the way things have gone so far, I think he was on the wish list, so to speak, and I'm sure he'd love to go play sevens. But at the moment, it's a fine balance for the seven guys. Yeah, you've got guys there with sevens contracts that are playing tournament in and out, and for the Neil Powell, the coach, to decide who, you can't just take a team of 15s. So he's got to keep that balance pretty well. So I think in the end, he's probably going to maybe play one or two sevens tournaments, but I don't see him going to Rio. I think he's going to be one of the guys who loses out when it comes to going to Rio.
Sure. Okay. So, to answer your question, Bruce, I'd say that definitely top five.
Yeah.
I wouldn't necessarily go any higher than that. I still would prefer Adi Savier. I'd still prefer Ioane. And I also just think that maybe, because those guys are also involved in sevens as well, that there's an argument there that David Pocock could sneak up there as well, just because of his consistency, and then we know he's going to score tries off the back of those mauls. That's just what he does.
Mm. Yeah, that's true. So the reason we didn't have Jukka Kurrell as the number one was that kind of home and away differential. So Tecklenburg and Whiteley were the ones that were scoring points when they were travelling New Zealand and overseas, because they were getting the tackles, you know, they were getting into that second bonus point realm. Mm-hmm. So I
think also, just on that from a fantasy point of view, I think Warren Whiteley is the guy who, over the last couple of seasons, is consistent the whole time. He's maybe not the star performer, but every single game, but his stats, I know we watch his stats quite often, and his stats are always up there.
Yeah, he's got a pretty high floor, hasn't he? He's not going to score you a zero all of a sudden.
Yeah.
What about Marnix Boshoff? So we had him fairly high ranked last year. We thought, we weren't too sure whether it's going to be Yankees or him, but it didn't get much of a look in last year.
No, I think Yankees had an excellent season last year. He was probably one of the players of the Lions, probably if not the player at the Lions, other than those loose forwards. But I don't see Marnix really coming back. I've worked with him a lot. He was at the Bulls before the Lions. He's maybe in the big games his head tends to dip a bit, and he's very much a confidence player. But limited when getting his backline going, and I think that's the big point there, is why Elton fits in better. Is Elton's more running first 5-8, where he's more the traditional kicks the goals sort of guy, and they've got other guys now who kick goals now, so unless there's injury, I can see Elton probably starting. Yeah. Plus, you got to also remember, Lions don't have a lot of players of colour in their team. I know it's going to sound strange to people in New Zealand, but there are transformation targets here, and 30% of the team is supposed to be players of colour, so to speak.
Is it starting 15 or squad?
Well, in terms of overall game time. So okay. It translates to 7 in the 23, I think we worked out. So, and it can't be that you put 6 on the bench and bring them on 2 minutes from time. It's got to be in terms of overall game time.
Okay.
Because coaches have done that in the past, so you can understand why they also make those rules. But, that's a whole different Pandora's box to get into. But yeah, that is also a factor there. And that's why I say I think Elton Yankees would probably start a lot more than Marnitz this year.
What about Andreas Kotsir? So he was really good last year. I loved watching him play last year at 15. He reminds me a bit of Ben Smith and Dane Haylett-Petty, he does a lot of things very, very well. Is he originally a 15 or was he a midfielder when he was coming up?
Well, he's played most positions in the back line at when they're junior level, but I think he's settled in lovely at 15. You know? And I agree with you. He's one of those guys you almost love to watch. You know, I'm just trying to think of the guy like Milner Scudder last year who came from nowhere, and the first time you see him, you just love the way he plays, and he's that type of guy. And he'll get a lot of games this year as well, and he'll make a lot of meters as well because he's quite a dangerous player as well.
He is, absolutely. All right, Mossman, any more from the Lions for you before we move on to the Bulls?
No, I just think that Yankees was he got his opportunity last year, and I think he took it. So there's absolutely no reason I think why he won't continue to do that. And I've personally got him pretty highly ranked as well. He's in that kind of range of fly halves where I'm quite happy to take one of those guys, and I don't consider that much of a step down.
Yeah, that's right. So we've got him at the start of the third round, which to mine, you know, is great value. Just great value.
Absolutely.
If he slips to you there, just punch the ticket and run.
Definitely.
I think another thing just on that one, if you're looking at, especially from fantasy, the Lions open the tournament against the Sunwolves. And that's their first game. So, there's every possibility that some players there are going to score a lot of tries and, a lot of points on the board in that first game. We hope it doesn't happen, obviously. for Super Rugby's sake, but it could easily happen as well. So,
there's a chance that the Sunwolves might not actually have 15 players to put on the field, I think, at that point. At the very least, some of them will be introducing each other, having not trained together, so.
That's right. So I just got off the phone to Rich Freeman as well about an hour ago. I had a podcast with him, just a quick Sunwolves update. And yeah, they don't get into camp for another week yet. And he's having a chat to Tier, and they're not playing any Super Rugby warm up either. They're playing against a top league team in their warm up. So I think there's a lot of support for them. And I hope it do well. It just might be growing pains.
It's an absolute shambles, let's be honest. It's like, if this was your school team and they weren't training this close to the end of the season, you'd be asking questions.
Yeah, but so the Crusaders were last in their first comp. Anyway, let's move on to the Bulls. I guess the big question...
I won't say how many times they were lost as well, so...
That's right. I think the big
question... I was there in Pretoria with those times, so it wasn't great.
Yeah, that is good. So, Andre Pollard, what do we think? We talked about that a little bit off the air, that there's a lot of players coming back from Japan picking up a few niggles, but he seems to have picked up a substantial injury. What's the latest there with him?
Well, that's the thing. The Bulls are sort of playing cat and mouse with us the whole time about his injury. They say they're putting him on a 4-week rehabilitation program, and then they'll reassess. What we've heard is that he's probably going to be out a little bit longer than that. I had a chat to him the other day, and he tells me it's a recurring injury from his school days.
Oh, really?
And obviously it's aggravated it because he's been playing so much rugby. So if you look at his stats, he's played probably 30, 35 games for the last 3 years every year. So he's played a lot of rugby for his age. And he's young, he can take it, but at some point your body's also going to push back. And I'm a bit worried that he might have to have an operation. I'm hoping it's not so. I know he's been to see three specialists already, so they're obviously trying to counter that. But I wouldn't make too many bets of him being involved in the first sort of 2-3 weeks of Super Rugby.
Yeah, it's a good question, that, isn't it? Because it's a young Bulls team as well, and there's been quite a bit of transition this year, and you wonder maybe if the smart thing is to look a little long-term and get that surgery done. I'm not sure if that actually will fix it, but yeah.
Yeah, I think their biggest problem is that there's no experience in that team, and they've got very, very little experience in that Bulls team. And I must say, a lot of talent. There's really a lot of good up-and-coming young talent in that team, and exciting talent. So they had a great Curry Cup season, probably not enough experience to get them through to the finals. They made it through the semis, but really some, and they played a brand of rugby under the new coach, Nolis Murray, which is totally anti-Bulls rugby.
That was one of my questions.
A lot more than the Lions.
What style does he play? What kind does he play?
Well, I think, they're not immune to going back to their normal sort of 10-man style when they need it. And they're obviously very strong in the set pieces, but, and then the mauls. But he likes a free-flowing game, very much the way the Lions like to play. So I think they're going to try and play that sort of game. And you know, from their point of view, this is the first year in a three-four-year plan for them. So they're not expecting too much this year. But it's more getting these guys into sort of, you know, that intensity of Super Rugby. And, you know, most of their team, probably if you look at their team, most of their team's going to be under 25 when they get onto the field.
Yeah, well, that's pretty impressive. Going back to Andre Pollard. So I've heard various reports on who might be starting fly half for the Bulls then as his backup. What's your best guess on that, Brennan?
Well, I'd say probably in the early stages, Francois Brimmer, played for the Cheetahs a couple of years ago. He's almost a journeyman. He's one of those guys who sort of floats around. He's been in about 6-7 different provinces. He's now back in Pretoria where he started his junior rugby. So he's about the most experienced guy there at 10. Tian Skuman, you might have seen a bit in Super Rugby right at the end last year. Very sort of white-haired, blonde-haired guy. Great kicker, good youngster, very good temperament, I must admit. He's maybe just a bit short in experience. And I think it comes down to who else is fit in that first game. I think I'd probably go with Brimmer for that first game or two, especially with the experience, you know, just to get the youngsters rolling. But I think Skuman will probably play a bigger role because I don't think Brimmer, to be honest, I don't think he's that good. I don't think he's super standard. He's pretty average at times, and he tends to disappear in games as well. And you can't really have your first five disappear too much in the season. So I think Skuman will probably come through at the end, or Andre will probably play the rest of the season.
And that's what I thought. So when I heard all the reports that Brummer was going to be the starting fly half, I was a bit surprised because I thought exactly the same thing. He looked like an okay player, a bit limited, but Tian Skuman. I'm glad that you've actually cleared up the pronunciation because I've butchered it for the last 3 weeks. Tian Skuman looked pretty good. Yeah, he looked like he had a pretty decent level head on him. I guess to your point, though, it's a young team, right? So having that little bit of experience.
Yeah, their first game's up against the Stormers at Newlands away from home.
Oh, bloody hell.
Yeah, and I think their second game's also at Derby. It's under, I can't remember who their second game is, but they're both local derbies. And I think the worry for the coach is that you send the young team that can do bad in that first game, and then suddenly you need a couple of older heads just to guide the guys through. So I think they'll probably be a little bit more conservative in selection, you know, in the first two or three games. Once if they get a good start, I can see those changes happening earlier rather than later.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that makes sense. Is there a temptation, and I guess this is probably for fantasy rugby draft managers, this is probably the most significant, aside from Pollard, is Jesse Creel. Is there a temptation to play him at 13, or is he going to be at 15, or is Gallant good enough at 15 to push him into that midfield?
Well, very much 13. That's okay. What we've heard, and we've had a couple of conversations with the coach, and he wants to play him at 13. He wants to give Warwick Gallant a lot of game time at the back. He's one of the rising stars the Bulls, and he's just as he's got the same sort of sidestep as Colby, probably built a bit better, a bit bigger, not much, but I suppose every kilogram helps at that level. And he's an excellent counter attacker. He scored a couple of brilliant tries in Curry Cup as well, playing through. So I think the natural progression is to try and give him as much game time as possible. Other than that, I mean, I hate always mentioning it, but the transformation thing comes back into the picture as well. Mm-hmm. And that's why Gallant, if you've got a player who's got talent like Gallant, then you give him a lot of game time as well. So that's the plan. And the Bulls have got quite a healthy competition in the midfield as well at the moment. Jan Serfontein's back, him and Creel. They got Birger Uerdendal, who's also a bit of a feisty midfielder as well. Yeah. Dries Swanepoel, who you guys probably won't know too much because he's been injured a lot of the time. He was Jan Serfontein's schoolboy midfield partner. And at schoolboy level, those two were devastating. So he's finally over his injury troubles, and he's had a full Curry Cup season. So he's also might force his way into thing there. And you know what, Gallant has played 13 as well at Vodacom Cup level. I've watched him play 13 as well. So he could also move into there. But they've got a lot of options in the midfield and the back three.
Yeah, so that's what I was looking at with the back three. Yulingo and Ishmael, is that on the other wing? Is that liable to be what happens? Bjorn Besson's floating around still, is he?
Bjorn Besson's a try scorer. He's always up there in the try scoring stakes. He knows how to cross the goal line. So I'd say he's the senior guy. He'd probably get the start there. Jumbo Lengo is also, him and Travels Ishmael, probably pretty much at the same level. Lengo's probably got a bit more bulk on him and, has a knack of, him and Chalant in the Curry Cup. Counted quite a lot together and scored a lot of tries between them. So I'd say he's probably got the nod ahead of Ishmael. But Ishmael's very much like Bjorn Besson, the same sort of player as well.
Okay, all right, nice one. I guess the stage opens up a little bit for Arno Botha, if he can stay fit. We're big fans, or at least I'm certainly a big fan. I guess he's made from the same cloth as Piers Beese. You know, he's a physical specimen, fast as well. I guess that big shock of hair at some point ran down the midfield, around in the middle of the field. But how was his Curry Cup? Is he fit?
Yeah, he's just come back from two horrible injuries. I mean, he had two knee ligament tears and that kept him out for almost a year in both of them. So the big question with him is will he stay fit? He's really had a bad run with injuries. Absolutely great player, and quite ironically this week we're talking about it as well, because the Bulls had to make a decision 2 or 3 years ago whether they keep him or CJ Stunder, who's just been named in the Ireland squad. So yes. And they went with Huerta, and since then he's hardly played for them. So it's just strange how life works when it comes to that. And CJ's been doing wonders up in Ireland for Munster. So if he can stay fit, it'd be great. There's a lot of good young up-and-coming. There's another guy, Hanro Liebenberg, who you might have seen at the SA Under-20 team. He was the captain at the Under-20 champs last year. He's also there, so he's the other candidate for eight. But I think the Bulls need Huerta to be fit. They need his experience as well. And he's definitely a sort of a lead-from-the-front type guy, so they need that in their team.
Yeah, I saw that Dion Stegman's out for 8 weeks as well. I saw the physio say something on YouTube yesterday about that.
Yeah, no, that's also a bad one, because I mean, Stegman's one of those players. He's never really going to be up at the level of a Heinrich Brousseau or that, but he's definitely a good journeyman type player, and he makes a lot of turnovers in games. But his experience, he was the captain in the Curry Cup last year for the Bulls. But got injured pretty early as well. So, they love his experience, because there's not too many other older guys, over 25 guys, should I say.
Yep.
And, they need that sort of player there. So it's a bit of a blow, that one, for them.
Mossman, to you, back onto the Jesse Creel thing. We have him 17th overall at the moment, but we have him listed as outside back, and we won't change that now because a lot of drafts have already happened. How far down do you think he falls then? Or does he fall?
It's an interesting one, isn't it? Because I think traditionally, Bulls outside backs have been a bit of a fantasy wasteland, really. Flattered to deceive and disappointed a lot of times. Even Besson, talking about him being a try scorer, hasn't really got it done, from a fantasy perspective anyway. And the midfielders there are similar. And Creel kind of changed that, last year. And a lot of that was about his counter attacking from the back. So the inclination is to say, well, he's probably not going to be as good from a fantasy point of view. But then, having actually seen him play in at centre for the Springboks, especially that one game against the All Blacks, where he scored a couple of tries, you think, well, maybe he's just that good a player that it's not going to make any difference. So there's a few competing kind of factors there. I would think, overall, I think I would expect him to not put up the same amount of points as he did last year. That would be my gut feeling.
Patrick Osborne or Jesse Creel?
I think it'll be Osborne, yep.
James Lowe, Jesse Creel?
Lowe, definitely, yep.
Goramaru?
Yep.
Andres Kotsia?
I can actually, rather than do this, I can tell you where I'm going, because we're going to be here all day, so just give me a second here. I do actually have...
So Ron Kumbrink's at number 40, and Mapo.
So I've got Creel at the moment at 13 among outside backs.
Okay, yep.
And so some of the names that I've got just ahead of him. So actually, yeah, all of the guys you mentioned, and then Cordero, Haylett Petty, Vicinia, and then him at 13.
Okay. All right. And is there anyone in the next kind of five names on the list below Creel that you actually would put above him now?
Possibly. We'll see what Brendan's got to say about Willie LaRue when we get to that.
Okay,
that's what we call a teaser in the business.
Nice one. All right. Anything more from the Bulls in general, Mossman, that you wanted to pull on, or Brendan yourself, actually?
I'm pretty good. I think what my biggest worry about them is that they are a young team. They're going to play some exciting rugby. I think a lot of rugby that people who've watched the Bulls over the years wouldn't have seen. They're not going to play traditional Bulls rugby. So I think that will do them well in terms of meters gained. I just wonder, when you play an expansive game, you've got to watch your defense as well. So, and being youngsters, sometimes you get a bit of over exuberance there. So I think that's the biggest question for me is whether their pack can still dominate like they have in the past, and two, how their defense is going to be with the new expansive game. But I don't expect them too much. I expect them to do pretty well in the South African Conference. But overall, I wouldn't pick them as semi-finalists.
Okay.
For me, I'd just say that Pollard was nailed on number two fly half for me before the injury. So it's almost a shame because it introduces that little bit of doubt. Like the player, like the draw he's got in terms of the teams he's going to go up against. Whether I stick with him at two, we'll see.
Okay, so I tell you what, I'm looking at the time. Perhaps we'll split this in two. And we'll come back on the other side and talk about the Sharks, Cheetahs and Kings. So a little bit of admin. You can follow us on Fantasy Rug Draft at Fantasy RUG Draft. And you can follow up Brendan at Brendan Nell. Thanks for downloading and listening. I'm Bruce Wilkinson. He's Nathan Mossman.
Charlie.
How's your opinion?